Thank you. It's a woman who know how to think.
No drama. We're good.
I don't belong here.
Maybe if you learned a thing or two, you'd never be stressed again.
You like this?
Who knows what'll happen?
What is going on in here?
That's the whole story.
Jason Bourne.
Every day's an adventure.
Okay, there we go. Hey, welcome back, everyone. Whether you're joining us here in person or streaming from your home, it's time for our next panel. This is Showrunner Sessions, Writing Drama, presented by HBO Max. Thank you, HBO Max. I'm here to introduce our moderator. She is an award-winning journalist and a prolific moderator. You've read her coverage of all things Hollywood in Fortune, New York Magazine, The Hollywood Reporter, and The New York Times. Please give a warm welcome to Stacey Wilson Hunt.
Noon. Can you hear me okay? Okay, great. How is everyone today?
Great.
Learning a lot and everything? It's so great. Thank you for that kind intro. I am Stacey, and I'm so honored to be here to speak to writers who are my favorite people, but they also drive me crazy because I'm married to one, so you know exactly how that goes. So I'm going to waste no time in bringing out our featured talent today, starting with writer and executive producer for In Treatment, Jennifer Schuur. Yes, please clap. Creator and executive producer of Station 11, Patrick Somerville. Come on out, Patrick. And writer, co-producer of Succession, Susan Soon-Hee Stanton. Firstly, thank you all for being here. I know it's no small thing to leave the home and make a journey to talk with us. So thank you so much. We really appreciate it. And you actually travel from Hawaii today. So this is a treat. Yes, I know, right? So before we talk about your amazing careers and your current series, I always love to ask writers to reflect on their nascency in the craft. And I'd love to know, what was the first thing you wrote that meant something to you? And I'll give you my example because it's really silly. I wrote a paper on Mozart in sixth grade and I laminated the cover and I thought it was like a work of art. So that was my moment. So Jennifer, how about you?
I wasn't probably going to go back that far.
I'm telling you, it can be anything you've written that meant something to you.
I think truly the thing that probably meant the most to me early on in my career, I'm old enough and have been writing long enough that spec scripts were still like very much the thing to help you get a job back in the day. And I had written a 6 feet under spec and it was the first thing I had ever written. But it meant a lot to me because I ended up writing about the death of a dog. Like a couple who their dog was their baby and they bring the dog to the funeral.
You never did a pet death on that show.
No.
What happened
all
with
those
Nate
seasons
in your episode?
I could tell you, but it's a little risque, so. But I remember it was after the death of a dog of mine, and you know, so I really sort of poured my heart into that, and it ended up being the thing that got me my first job. So,
do you know if Alan Ball ever had a chance to read this script?
I would doubt it.
Okay, he was busy at the time.
Yes,
that is a great example. And how about you?
When I was 7 years old, I wrote a short story called "If I Were a Molecule," and that I decided to be a writer on that day when I read it to the class. That's a pretty simple, straightforward answer. That was the day.
Was this in first grade?
Yeah, it was first
wow.
grade.
Wow, and you said the word molecule as a first grader. That's very
That was
advanced.
The prompt. I didn't okay. know that word. But the prompt was basically Honey, I Shrunk the Kids, but just, you know, really little
that was adventure. The comp, if you will.
Yeah. I also tried to write a Nintendo game when I was in fifth grade. I sent it to Nintendo on an envelope.
That's so
cute. It was
on
a legal, it was legal paper, legal pad paper, folded. They never wrote me back.
See, these auspicious beginnings can take any form, I think we've heard. And how about you? What was your breakthrough moment as a writer?
For me, it was my first full-length play, and I think it was that experience of seeing it done in front of a live audience and hearing, and I think there's something about sitting when your work's being performed, whether it's like, I mean, TV, it's more rare, but also in film where you just watch bodies like reacting, sometimes good, sometimes bad, leaning forward, leaning away, and that was a really impactful experience for me.
Right.
When
Thank
was
you for
that?
Sharing those.
It was in the aughts.
In the aughts.
Way back when, in the aughts. And no writer has success without feeling supported by someone in their career, whether early on, midway, now, in the future. And I'd love to know, who was someone in your career who supported you and told you, you have to do this, and really pushed you to keep doing it, even when it was so painful, as it always is? Who was that person, Patrick, for you?
Well, you know, I think I had this sort of intense desire to be a writer that came from my own imagination when I was little. And I grew up in Green Bay, Wisconsin. I grew up in a place kind of not surrounded by artists. My mother was a prolific reader, but I didn't know that you could kind of go into the arts. It was very far away. So for a long time, I think it was a mission I was on personally, but it really, you know, I was a novelist in my 20s and early 30s. I guess I still am, but I haven't written a novel in 10 years. But it really was the transition from writing fiction to coming to Los Angeles to be a screenwriter and to work in television and visual storytelling. The theater, the idea of seeing people doing your thing, the opening up into a collaborative mode instead of being by yourself is quite a different thing. But I would say the validation I felt from just getting the job, I got a job from Chicago on a show called The Bridge for FX as a
Love
staff writer. I had no experience, I was green, I had no idea. But Elwood Reed, the co-showrunner, was a novelist, and I think he was looking for someone with a different set of experience, and so he was open to it. And then Meredith Steam, our presidents.
Yes, all hail the president.
These were my first two bosses, and I guess I Skyped with them. It was called Skype in 2012. It was very unusual.
Back when it was sort of fun and like a novelty to be able to communicate
It was very weird. From Chicago, and we talked for 20 minutes. They loved the script I had written. And the fact that they hired me, I think, just was this sense of validation. That was just, I had published 4 books, and I was, you know, I was on that path. I had had plenty of validation professionally, but there was something about the fact that they said, come write our show with us, help us write our show, that I really feel like it changed my, I don't know, my self-worth, like my sense of value of like, there's a way you can fake it when you're writing fiction where you never quite know if you pretend or not. I don't know if that makes sense, but getting starting to work with other people just really changed my life.
And that show was also an adaptation itself, correct? Of a Scandinavian series?
Ilbron?
Yes,
Ilbron. The Swedish show, The Bridge, yeah.
Right. So maybe there was a sense of we're drawing from existing IP, but we're all sort of coming into it equally, in a sense, maybe. And maybe that's why he felt comfortable bringing in another novelist.
I was so afraid and underwater, I was not thinking about things like that. I was just like, don't embarrass yourself, don't embarrass yourself.
I love that show. It's really one of my favorite
Thank
series
you.
In the last, however long it's been, a decade at this point. And Jennifer, who or what inspired you to keep going and told you that you did have what it takes to persevere?
You know, I would say that I also am from a tiny town in Washington State where no...
Where are you from in Washington?
Puyallup.
I love Puyallup.
You
yeah.
do?
Oh, I went to school in Tacoma.
Did you go to UPS?
I did, yeah. I love Puyallup.
This is great, you guys. This is really great.
So have you been to the fair?
I've been to the fair many times.
Yes, okay.
But I understand.
The largest fair in the nation. In
not
my
a lot
tiny
of art
town.
Comes out of Puyallup. I know exactly what
There's
you're
150
talking.
People in the room. Just kidding.
It's actually bigger than that. It's just all like suburbia, yes. Big box stores, and you know, it's not exactly the a bastion of art making. And
this is like Green Bay too.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm the only person who has ever left, and I came. I actually transferred halfway through my undergrad degree to film school at USC. And I think that was probably the moment where I felt. And once I was there, and I was on a directing track, on a production track there, and I really felt like there were, by the end of my degree, everyone knew that I was the writer of all of these directors, you know? And I knew that was going to be at least my path early on. And I think that was real. I mean, it didn't mean that it translated into an instant writing career. I mean, I was an assistant for 5 years, around town to various different kinds of executives. I once coordinated dailies at Columbia Pictures. I mean, I did a lot of different things. And each time I was such a terrible assistant that all of my bosses would be like, you should really just keep pursuing the writing thing.
I have a question about I have friends who've gone both tracks in film school. And there is this sense with directors where you think they would have a proclivity for writing because mm-hmm. directing is writing. Mm-hmm. But so often, as you just said, directors really are very single focused and mm-hmm. they aren't naturally writers, which mm-hmm. I always am so surprised to hear because I assume that filmmakers are adept at storytelling, you know, on the page, and you were distinct, it sounds like, in that way.
That's why they need us. That's why it's a good partnership. We need them, they need us. Yeah.
That's a great story. Thank you. And how about you? Who was supportive of you in your career? It could be very early on, it could be recently.
I'm also from a really small town. I thought about different writing mentors I've had, which are really important. But I was going to say that my father is a poet and my mother is Asian. And
is that a job?
No, I guess it was just that thing of like my mother always was really pushing me to be an orthodontist, which was the big because like nobody dies, you make really good money, you set your own hours. But I think because I was like, well, you married a poet. And they don't make a lot of money. So there was this mixture of like strive and work really hard, but also like it's okay to just tell stories and dream and do something. So, you know, that's why like I got the BFA and the MFA because, you know, those are not the most necessarily the most practical kind of degrees. But in terms of, and I feel like it's interesting to hear everyone's journey into TV and film because for me it was so much through playwriting. I feel like a lot of my examples are through theater, but I think it's about like just cultivating your voice, like figuring out like dialogue and how the thinking about building character. So Paula Vogel, who was my MFA professor at Yale and has become a really dear friend, she was just an incredible mentor. And the piece of writing that I wrote that ended up like getting me originally staffed, you know, that came from, you know, so I was originally staffed from a play, and most of my writing samples are plays. And so that's something that I always find kind of like remarkable is that like you can sort of have a sort of around the way kind of journey into, yeah.
And what led you to playwriting? Just seems so difficult to me. Out of all the options and formats, what led you down that path, and what inspired you to pursue that particular genre?
I love toggling. I mean, I feel like the different forms are really different. Like film is like this serialized, and then, TV is in film, but in theater, the playwright is king. You know, every word you write is your own. You don't get paid very much, but you always own it. And so, which felt really healthy to toggle between like I'm part of a room, or I'm part of this big whole. I'm just contributing, or I'm a part of a writing staff. I'm contributing towards like another writer's vision. And then in film, it's really a director's medium in so many ways. I mean, I think you can facilitate that, and the screenwriter is really important. But if you're not on a tour, it's a different relationship. And then in theater, it's sort of like, here's the play, I've written it, and one way or another, we're gonna put it up, and then all the writing is yours. And I feel like toggling between those different forms for me is very healthy in terms of maintaining my identity as an individual voice as a writer.
I love that. And you never go to a play that you've written and someone's cut scenes without telling you.
They're not, well, then I could shut it down because that's the thing about right. owning your copyright. So yeah, they can't. Hopefully they can't. I mean, right. maybe it happens, but.
Right, yeah. But you have definitely more ownership is essentially, right. That's great. Thank you for sharing those stories. There's no one way to make it, as we know. So I'd love to talk about your current series for which you're here today. I'm gonna start with Jennifer and In Treatment. How many people have seen the latest iteration of In Treatment with Uzo Aduba? Yeah? Okay, you have more to watch. More to watch over the holidays. It's fantastic, and I love, love, love the early iteration of the series with Gabrielle Byrne. It's so great. I read a story on NPR a few weeks ago that made me think of In Treatment, and it was Ayesha Harris talking about what she calls the black lady therapist trope in television, and she brought up all these examples, and it really has become sort of an archetypal character, for better and sometimes for worse. And she cited this show as being one that not only gave great dimension to this character, but really expanded beyond that side character sort of piece of the storytelling, and we see her struggle in her own life with addiction, with relationships, et cetera. So I'd love to know, when you were crafting this new iteration and centering it on Uzo's character, what were the conversations that you were having to make sure that she was at the forefront of the storytelling?
I mean, when you get an actor like Uzo Aduba, you want to write for her. I mean, that's
She was cast
one.
And you were writing for her.
We had there was the idea of having the therapist be a black female therapist, but she came on very early in the process, and once we knew we had such talent to work with, it allowed us to really open up the ideas about the show spends a lot more time in this iteration with the therapist than it did with Gabriel Byrne back in the original. I mean, you would get bits and pieces of his life, but we really wanted to make the fullest version of a therapist who can help you and also needs help. And to be able to do that in a way that felt, you know, that honored the original, but at the same time sort of expanded upon it and gave us an opportunity to really get to know this woman, whether she be, you know, black, Asian, and, you know, we just wanted to make a great, full, realized character.
Tell me a little bit about how you crafted the episodes, and this was during COVID you were writing, and then you shot, you were saying backstage, at this time last year you were in production. So did you start the quote-unquote room over Zoom? How did you guys do this?
We did. We didn't do a room with all the writers all together. Because each writer wrote one character, one patient for the season, we would work with them one-on-one. It was nice in the sense that there's not all of these voices all the time. We got to have really in-depth conversations, and then you could also get off Zoom a lot sooner. You know, it didn't need to be so long-winded. But that, it was interesting. I there are two of the writers that I have never met in person, which is like so bizarre, because usually in a room, like that's one of the best parts about being a writer is a writer's room. I love it.
Can I ask, you have met them though. This is the thing, I'm asking more, like, because for example, Lucy Cherniak, who directed two episodes of Station 11, I met via Zoom.
Uh-huh.
Only saw her face via Zoom, but when I would see her in real life, I couldn't see her face
right on
set. But yet, those intensive 2 weeks of prep, like I felt like I knew Lucy.
Yeah. Yes.
I had met her. So like, I'm trying to figure out the language for this thing.
I know.
When we meet people digitally and we know them.
Right.
But it counts.
It absolutely does. Certainly.
But it's weird.
It's very weird. It's just odd to not know how tall somebody is or how, you know, because they're sitting in, you know, it's a big mystery. There's some mysterious pieces of it, but you do get to know their inner selves, I think, just as well, I think, in a way. So.
It was always a really warm, happy feeling to see Lucy after that 2 weeks in person, to be like, she's not quite a stranger anymore. Like that's something, it's not all the humanness of being together,
right.
But it counted for some enough to go work together and collaborate.
Yeah,
too.
I mean, we're making it work.
Yeah.
We really are.
Well, on the subject of COVID, I would love to know, you obviously wrote it into the show. We see episode one, she's zooming with Anthony Ramos's character, Eladio. Mm-hmm. And clearly we know that this is not a traditional therapy session. How much balance did you want to bring to acknowledging the pandemic, obviously wanting to make sure this wasn't existing in some fantastical version of LA where people weren't affected, but also not dwelling on it so much that it becomes sort of like the focus of every patient's visit?
Yeah. I mean, that was we had a lot of conversations about that. And I do actually think there is a version of the show where it is just a COVID show and it's talking about COVID.
And it could work, actually.
I totally believe that. But I also felt like it is also limiting. I think there are a lot of other things that people are struggling with. And the thing about In Treatment is you get to actually write a show in the moment for the moment. That's happening. It's coming out so fast. I mean, we did it from conception to air in 8 months, 24 episodes. It was the most insane thing I have ever been a part of. But also ultimately like the coolest thing, because you knew that the things that you crossed your fingers, but you really knew that the biggest issues that you were talking about that were affecting our lives in the present are still going to be there in 6 months. And you know, we did get lucky with a few things. We projected that there would be vaccines, like we predicted there would. We crossed our fingers.
Willed it to happen.
And yes, and in fact, they were around by the time the show aired, so that was really helpful. We did want to be able to say that COVID was happening, but we also wanted to put these actors in the same room together, and we didn't want them masked. Then you're losing all the things that are great about an actor, you know. So we really, it was threading a very particular needle, and there was a lot of conversation about how far to go with it, and we just did our very best to strike a balance that felt realistic, but also allowed us to tell all sorts of stories about this exact moment in time.
Well, you did a great job. That's an incredible timeline. I'm really stunned to hear that it was that fast. So congratulations. That's truly staggering achievement. And Patrick, let's talk about Station 11. You probably haven't seen Station 11 because it hasn't aired yet.
But I hope you haven't.
I've seen it, but it's only because I had a secure link. But here's the log line. Survivors of a devastating flu pandemic try to rebuild their lives after losing everything. So nice escapist
LOL.
Entertainment. LOL. So I was watching episode one, which is really great. And firstly, I do have a question. Remember when COVID first started and we were all in lockdown? I remember seeing that Outbreak was the number one streaming movie at that time. And it made me ask myself and ask all of us, what is wrong with us or right with us that we are seeking to watch something that is so closely mirroring our lives? And I'd love to know psychologically, what is it about these stories? Because the show is amazing. I cannot wait to keep watching it. But after everything we've been through, why do I want to watch this?
Well, before I try to answer that, I will make a distinction that we were prepped and in production in the fall of 2019 and shooting in January and February of 2020.
This was all in advance of everything.
And completed two episodes around the time our world was overtaken with COVID. And so this we didn't set out to make a show about what was happening. We found ourselves in the middle of that situation. That alone was quite an insane experience.
Well, how did that feel for you, too, when you had to shut down? I know that was very hard.
Well, we had a plan to shut down already at the end of February because we needed to get to summer. We were shooting our before. Two episodes worth of what the world was before devastation. And we shot it in the before. The first episode of the show is in a crowded theater, and I was talking to these two before. We had 300 extras.
I was wondering that, watching that scene.
You can't have 300 extras now, but we could then. And so when I see it, I'm like, well, thank God we shot this then.
That was very good timing.
Yeah, but there's the subway, the L in Chicago, there's people on the streets, and then going to Toronto a year later, I will say we had a plan to shut down. We did. It happened to coincide with COVID just shutting down our industry. We were going to come back up in Chicago in June, and instead we had two great episodes. We had the support of HBO Max. Everyone was waiting and living through that stuff in March and April and May, and we looked around and we decided we didn't think we wouldn't be able to protect our crew shooting in Chicago if we came back up in the fall at that time. There was no vaccine. There were, I think, 70,000 active cases in Chicago, and there were 125 in Toronto, or in all of Ontario at that time. And the show was in the Great Lakes region, and it felt like our world, and it felt like a move creatively that made sense. So we made the move, and then that's a few more months, and you know, all the unions were negotiating at that time to make some kind of agreement that made production make sense. And we got to Toronto. We moved our sets. We trucked them across the border. And so the apartment that Jeevan and Kirsten are in at the end of episode one, we packed it up in a semi and drove it to Toronto and reconstructed it in Toronto. And 1 year later, in January 2021, I was standing in the same apartment, but I was in Toronto. And we were picking up the next day in the story world, but it was a year later and we had all lived through a pandemic. So it was a lot. But to go back to your first question, I don't think of that thing as what's wrong with us.
I meant that joking.
Yeah, no, I know, but that gets said all the time, and we see it in the landscape of people trying to forecast the marketplace and say, oh, well, people don't want that. They want to feel happy right now. People don't want to talk about, and I'm like, people want to talk about what's real. Right. People want to talk about what they feel, and people want to communicate about emotions that are new that we don't have language for. People need stories to get this out of us, you know, because like we're fucked up from the pandemic. We are, and there needs to be new, this is our job, I think, which is to find a way to tell a story that lets people feel a thing that they need to feel.
I have found when I watch shows, like Shameless was actually great about integrating the pandemic, which obviously the show takes place in Chicago. I felt comforted watching people wear masks and talk about like losing money and losing jobs.
There's all these new little wrinkles in social
situations.
Yeah, and I think in treatment is a grounded realism world, and we were all the way on the end of the spectrum of like, okay, I guess. So we made a show about a flu that kills 99.99% of the human population in 3 days. And we're 2 episodes in, and now we're experiencing a flu that's kind of more like the leftovers percentages, but yet doing all of these chronic, strange, invisible, difficult things to us. And there's a lot of death too, you know? But we had a good conceptual framework beforehand, which was what Hiro and I said when we went to sell the show. Hiro was like, I don't like post-apocalyptic shit. And I was like, I don't really either, but I love this book. And he was like, I don't like Shakespeare. And I was like, come on, this is gonna be, but this is the beginning of our, but my point is,
Hiro Murai, the director.
Hiro Murai, the director of those 2 episodes in Chicago. My point, I think, is that we wanted to make a show about joy. That was kind of our take. It was, if you're gonna kill 8 billion people to start your show, you don't owe more pain, story-wise. You owe rebuilding and joy and life. You can't do that between episodes 1 and 2 and then keep going back to pain as your energy of story. I was like, I think let's do this genre, but do it in that way. So we had the right conceptual framework, I think, to be able to stay relevant when COVID came.
And how did that narrative structure compare? And he also did work on The Leftovers, speaking of The Leftovers. That's, like you said, very similar conceit, but ultimately the, you know, different stakes. How did the writing feel different to you in terms of the way, obviously based on Tom's book, but in terms of pacing the show?
Tom's book, Damon's presence in the room, two formidable writers, I think, working together in a quite a spectacular energy thing that I got to watch and sit and be like, holy,
those guys
shit
are amazing. Yeah.
These guys. I think that The Leftovers always felt to me more about depression, honestly, or about
loss.
About loss, yeah. and death, and mystery. How do we deal with the not knowing?
Right.
And Station 11 is about art, I think, and building things together with people. And they kind of map onto each other in a way, but they're fundamentally different in terms of like what they care about. So, you know, they're both. I would say we tried to be very funny in Leftovers room to make up for kind of our own pretentiousness, or we tried at least, and weird and just light sometimes. And I think Station 11, what I brought from Leftovers to Station 11 was, don't get too up your own ass about like this is some art, Shakespeare, everyone's dying, like have fun and let the audience have fun when you can find the space.
That is great. And I've only seen the first episode, but now I'm so excited to see what you do from here, because that rebuilding theme, I think, is really cool. And by the way, it's something we're all dealing with right now. I mean, that rebuilding, how do we recover and build
takes
new
20 years.
It takes 20 years. We all gotta get started.
Great.
Thank you for that. That was very interesting. And Susan, it makes so much sense knowing now that you are a playwright, and the work that you do on Succession, I have a feeling they're very inextricably linked to each other. At least as a viewer, it feels very theatrical in the best possible way. And there's so much, when people write about the show, there's so much back and forth about, oh, it's a comedy, it's a drama, because people really do like to say it's the funniest show on TV, when I know, and you know, its format suggests that it's not a comedy. I find it to be the funniest show on TV. So I'd love to talk about the humor piece of it, how much improv is taking place, if at all, and also working with your British cohorts who are so funny, and it's Tony and Jesse. What have you learned about humor from writing with those guys? Because they really bring this like slicing wit to everything that they do.
Yeah, I mean, it's an interesting process. I don't think we begin with comedy. I mean, I think the room is thinking about like the composition of a writer's room. I think there's a mixture of sort of playwrights and also these really brilliant comedic minds that are, but also very political, very involved, like, you know, like British political comedy writers. And so there's a seeking, there's a point of view there that I think is always present. And so we do a lot of research and dig up horrible things. But I think that counterpoint is like, how do you make the horrible thing funny? Or just a point at, you know, like how can you make anything when the world is so absurd, right? And so I think we sort of build out the scripts, and then we go over it and over it and over it in terms of the writings. The language is very heightened. And, you know, we'll kind of write, I think, what might look like a normal scene, a normal dialogue, or normal-ish, and then we'll just go over it and over it. And so we go through many, many drafts. Like, I think our shooting script for episode 305 was, like, draft 72. You know, we just keep, like, going over it. And then I just heard the funniest growth of the idea.
Can tell. I mean, you can tell that much work has gone into it.
And then we also do alts, right? So, like, Jesse will... So we'll, all of us will kind of write on episodes, all the episodes, like, especially being on set, we'll all just be, like, huddled with our laptops. And so Jesse will bold certain exchanges, like, okay, if we have to end the scene earlier, here's the... So then we would all write possible alternate lines. Like, here's a funny way of saying it that's very British. Here's the kind of, like, the very quick, here's the crude way, you know, here's the earnest way. And sometimes... You don't really know what the right button is until you in the edit, in terms of like what's too written or what, you know. And when you hear it out of the actor's mouth, is this cadence right? Because there's a lot of cadence to the British humor that you try to write to. And so we'll kind of get the scene as it's written, and then we'll do some of our alt lines, and some of the actors are more comfortable than others with alts, but they're all really growing into it, and they're brilliant. I mean, Kieran Culkin is the master of alts. He wants every single alt, you know, and he just fires them off. And then they'll have sort of wild takes where they will improv and let things get messy and just play with it. And so I feel like it's a hybrid for the scenes of carefully written lines and then some of our alts and then the brilliance they come up with. And it's such an ensemble show, and they have such deep relationships as you know, actors and friends, and will rehearse on their own and come up with things. And yeah, it's really lovely.
Can I ask a question? I'm just fascinated. In those like wild moments or riffing and all those, that kind of free space for different buttons, do you guys ever find dramatic stuff that was unexpected or emotional moments that weren't part of the plan, but the actors kind of found?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think especially with Jeremy, he's always looking for things like the action, you know, like drawing a glass or putting away, or, you know, there's a lot of moments where somebody will just, a lot of it's in the action, but sometimes they'll come up with things. I would say it's a hybrid. They'll be in the moment, and then they have, especially the series regulars, they have that freedom to know that they can play, especially later on, although ask the director, can we do this? And a lot of the physical spacing, they'll put themselves in the places and find things. I feel like Nick Braun will always have props in his hands.
Cousin Greg.
Yeah, they'll be like, why are you holding this? And then in the edit, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is so funny. But he'll somehow manage to get himself into a corner and then hold up something ridiculous. And Arian, who plays Stewie, always figures out how to eat. And we don't always tell him to eat. And he always now just eats. So
he's hungry. It's a long day.
Yeah.
Well, I was rewatching 305. This is a great, one of your many great bottle episodes where this show's so great, but I often find myself not understanding how to describe what's happening in each episode because I don't totally get it because I'm not really a business person. But what would you say is happening in this episode? They're waiting to find out if Sandy, yes. So they're waiting to find out if he's agreeing to, can you just tell me exactly what's going on? Because I even rewatched it and I don't totally get it.
Hopefully, I mean, we try to get the details right, but let it sort of wash over you like water. So if it's, if you're into it, it's okay, you know, you can enjoy it. But otherwise it's like, don't get too fussed about it. Right. But they're at the point where they're major shareholders and at the brink of a possible hostile takeover. So the shareholder meeting, they're introducing a bid. And so the two sides can settle and then it'll never come to a vote. But if it does come to a vote, then all these shareholders. So it's like if you had a single stock in Apple, or if you have a single stock of Waystar Royco, then you could then bid on whether, you know, Logan and everyone else can still be in control of the company, or this hostile bid can take over. So it was kind of like, do we let them vote or not? And there was a mad scramble where it should have been decided weeks ago, and they're deciding up to the moment.
Wow. And have you learned a lot about business working on the show? Things that you never thought you'd know?
Unfortunately, yes.
Just the deep depravity that is our capitalist system.
Yeah, I mean, it's a mixture of like knowing actual, like I watched, I would say, dozens of AGMs, and we'll do lots of research, but then there's also just reading the business, you know, just hearing business stories, and sometimes it's just really like, wow, then the moral of the story is they got away with it and made a lot of money and everything was fine, and like they lived their lives and nothing ever came of consequence to them. You're like, okay.
But then so it's up to you to bring consequence to their actions, even though legally they may never face true consequences.
Often no. I mean, and I think in the show, like, we're also showing like what is the consequence? You think you do the right gesture, and then will there be the payout that you hope? I mean, even in fiction, right? It's a complicated world. And
again, rewatching 305, Greg, he's just so ridiculous and so wonderful. He's in the scenes with his grandpa. Just this one line is so silly, but so wonderful. He says, "You're the best darn grandpa out." And he's talking to his grandfather, and they're walking. His grandfather's always agitated with him. Now, is that line actually written, "You're the best darn grandpa out," and that's actually in the script? Or is that something that Nicholas just sort of added a flourish to? Like, tell me how that came about.
Oh, no, we wrote it.
That's the writers.
No, it's just because each actor is so wonderfully catered to the way he or she speaks and vice versa. If that feels to us like something that he just sort of off the cuff said, which is, of course, the point. We want it to feel like organic language. So to your earlier point about how the actors are now really settling in, who is your favorite character to write for or write to at this point that makes you feel very energized? If you can choose, I know it's hard.
It kind of feels a bit like Peter and the Wolf, you know, where every character is their own instrument and they have their kind of cadence, you know. I mean, I think that, yeah, like Logan is kind of like, I mean, I want to say he's like the shark in Jaws, but you want to make sure you don't have him just say like fuck off and make him too blunt, but you also don't want to show too much of him. I mean, Shiv is sometimes very mysterious and doesn't always show her hand. I mean, the most fun, like the most ice cream, is just the like writing for Tom and Greg, but I love writing for Roman because you can write the most outrageous things ever, and then he'll just say them. So I would say in terms of like fun, like pure fun, it's Roman. But then you don't want to, again, it's that thing of like, it's very easy to overtip, and so it's the dance of how much can we put in and how much do we need to pull out. And there are so many really fun things that we just took out because it's like, oh wait, that's too many ingredients, or you know.
That balance just must be amazing to maintain. It's really very impressive. Thank you for walking us through that. So everyone here has been through a COVID season of their show, to say the least. What are you most proud of, looking back on all this incredible work that you've done, that you really just couldn't have imagined that you would have been able to execute now, and allowing yourselves a moment of, I know writers don't like to do this, but that you did a good job? Jennifer, what is that for you?
When we were shooting, I think it was a really scary time for anybody to be in production. I think we were one of the first shows to be back up in Hollywood, period. And I think the care that was taken with all of the human beings on set that are putting their lives on the line, you know, it felt like that at the time, for sure. You know, they are leaving their families every day. Everybody wants to be working, but we're stepping out of our homes for the very first time.
Without vaccines at that point.
Without vaccines, no, there were not vaccines. And to have run a set that never shut down because of any COVID outbreak or anything like that, I take a lot of pride in that. I think it was asking a lot of people to come and do the show, and my goal was to try to take care of them as best we could. And we did, and that I feel very proud about that.
That's amazing. Congratulations.
I feel the same. I'm keeping everyone safe. This has to be my first answer also, because when you're the showrunner, it felt like it was gonna be your fault if someone died, honestly. And that's not, that was a different time too, and I think we slowly came to understand, like, it's not about binary nobody getting COVID. It's more about outbreak prevention. And like there are, it was, but it was very scary in the summertime then when we just didn't really understand what it would even look like to be on set, you know? But I would just add to that, you know, artistically I'm very happy and satisfied with the show, but I would just say in terms of leadership, which is not something we as writers typically start with as a skill, I'm proud of just holding everyone together. It's really hard to communicate and be human and like tolerate how hard it is to be in production without not being able to go get a drink after, without not being able to see someone's face.
That's the fabric of why we do this work, is like the socializing and the debriefing and the like, oh my God, let's all hang out after.
It's hard, you know, like, and people cry because they're exhausted and devastated that, you know, there's 1,000 problems every day, and it's not always safe psychologically, I think, making TV. And then to add the restrictions we add required, I think, like an additional layer of attunement for all the producers to think about things in a humane way as much as we could. I mean, we failed sometimes too. We missed things all the time. It was not easy to shoot in a pandemic, but I am proud of our system and our team of producers, our production office. We never went down a day either, and we shot 138 days. I'm proud of trying to stay human, and humanize people who feel dehumanized sometimes inside system. I'm talking about below the line more than anything.
Well, we saw that come to a head recently, didn't we? Yeah. Well, thank you for your leadership.
Part one.
Yes, part one, exactly. To be continued. And how about you?
Yeah, I mean, I was just really moved by
yeah, that was really nice.
Yeah, I mean, it's that thing of like, it's this, you know, it's like the made up conversations, and then you put people's health on the line. I remember talking to our script supervisor who said, I was like, what have you been doing? And she hadn't worked until she came on Succession. She's like, well, I don't want to risk my life for a show that, you know, like that isn't like worth it. And then I thought, oh, but then you're saying this is, and I felt kind of staggered by the statement, even though I felt like everyone who shows up is a part of that. And so I think making it, I mean, we had a really big delay. We just kept pushing and pushing. And so we started shooting finally like mid-November. Of 2020.
Like exactly a year ago you were shooting.
Yeah. And we had been, you know, it had been such a long time since we saw everybody. And so now, I mean, I feel like, and I think we had a big thing of like how much we need to change our scripts or, you know, and I think what was really amazing was that we had to do some tiling. We didn't get the 300 extras in a couple of scenes we wanted them, or, you know, like there were some things that changed. We shot sometimes out of order, but then it kind of allowed, and we were hoping for a vaccine, so we allowed the stories to get shot. Like one of the last things we shot was Shiv is supposed to spit into a notebook, and it was a really simple idea, and then it became like, can we have this gesture anymore?
Contact lenses. Oh my God. Anything to do with contact lenses. Yeah. There was stuff like that was really hard.
Yeah. Wow. Yeah. So just things that, you know, even a year and a half ago would have been as simple.
You wouldn't have blinked, and then it became like just meetings and meetings, and like, can we do this? And like, oh, and I don't know. And then,
And then do you just choose to not include it at that point and just write around it or do something else?
I think if it was kind of like, we don't want to punish the story. I think there were some times where you have to do things safely or things that made sense. And then we delayed some things to the end that we saved them once everybody could be vaccinated. And you know, but yeah, it was really tough. And not also, we were all in such close communication with our actors, and you're kind of in these different zones, and you're wearing all this gear, and you can't talk to a performer without wearing a mask and a face shield, and especially people that you have met for the first time in person, it does, you know, it is harder.
Well, I would never know that a pandemic had taken place in watching any of your shows, so well done.
Except for mine.
Except for yours.
When everyone dies.
But just the fictional pandemic, but not the real one. So we have a few minutes left, and I do want to open it up to anyone in the audience who may have a question or two. And please let these be questions and not so much testimonials, because that is always better. Okay, the first hand I saw is the pink T-shirt.
Hello.
Okay. Hi. And just speak loudly if you could.
Yes, I have a question for Susan. So it's about piss mad. So the phrase piss mad in the most recent episode felt very British, and I just wanted to know how that came about.
Yeah, it was definitely like a King George kind of like the King's water is blue, piss mad. Yeah, it's definitely like a Britishism, I guess. Yeah.
Okay, so it was already written. It wasn't improvised.
It was written in the script. Yeah.
That was the writers, again. I got your back.
So everything these people say on screen, you guys wrote. That's how this works. No, I'm just kidding.
Thank you.
Anyone else? I saw a few other hands. Okay, over here. I can't see what you're wearing, but over there.
This is the tried and true question that you probably get a million times, but what's some, like, piece of advice that you would give an up-and-coming writer as they're starting their career?
Who wants to take that?
I have one that I like to share because it was something that helped me. I find, you know, you go to events, you mingle, you work, you know, jobs that you can get in the business, and as you meet people who are in a position to potentially help you, I always encourage people to ask something very specific of somebody versus saying, I really want to be a writer, I have this script, would you read it? And then if you think of anything that you can do for me, that would be great. If you see anything, for me, I had written my 6 Feet Under spec, and I had an opportunity to get it in front of Carolyn Strauss, who was the head of HBO at the time. And I had read the pilot of Big Love, and I loved it. And so instead of saying, can you read my script? And then if there's anything at HBO that you have going on, I would love, you know, to be a part of it. I said, I have read Big Love. I would love to be a part of that. And if you see anything, you know, that would be great. And she read it, and she told me that, you know, the show was not picked up yet to series. And she said, if it gets picked up, I will make a call for you to the showrunners. And so I went off and walked dogs for a summer, crossing my fingers. And then she followed through on that. She called the showrunners and got me a meeting, and that translated into my first job as a writer in television. And so I offer that to say it is sometimes very hard for busy people to think about the perfect opportunity for you, but if you bring them something very specific, that people want to help. Like, people do want to help. They get to a position where, oh my gosh, I'm so lucky I get to help people now. But if you give me something very specific to do, I can do that very easily. So, anyways, that's my little
great awesome advice.
Be ready. You knew what to
right
say.
Right here in front.
Can I ask a follow up to that?
Of course.
Can I ask a follow up to that? How did you read the pilot before it got picked up?
I was actually an assistant at HBO at the time.
Ah, there we go.
Yes. The plot
be an
thickens
assistant.
Yeah. But yes, I was the assistant to the head of comedy at HBO at the time. And I did, that was my last year being an assistant, and she recently reached out to me through an agent. She did not even remember, that's how bad I was. I didn't even make a dent in her, in her life. She had no memory of me working on her desk. It's terrible. But I was there at the time. So I was reading the project that they had in development. And
well, at least you can't take credit for you then.
That's a good point, exactly. Anyone else around the side?
I haven't watched Succession yet because I prefer to binge watch. So how do you guys watch TV now? Do you prefer all the episodes to be out? And does it affect how you write as well?
Yeah. I have trouble watching TV at the moment, I have to say. And there is something about the total tsunami of production and being underwater where it's hard to describe, like, you can't, there's no, it's impossible to watch television when you're in production or post. We just finished our last mix 3 weeks ago, and this is like a 2 year thing. So my wife has watched 20 more shows than me, and we usually watch them together. So I'll take them anyway, though. So I guess to answer your question too, I'll binge them. I'll go weekly. I'll watch three, whatever, if it's fun and enjoyable. We have three kids too, so watching 8 episodes of anything is a thing of the past. I'm excited to get back into the place where I just watch like I used to and just can enjoy all the work of our colleagues.
Great. Anyone else? Right in front.
Hi, so I actually have a question for Patrick. So you worked on Maniac, I was looking at, I guess it was adapted from a Norwegian book that was kind of similar, but the premises seemed completely different. How did that go into your writing for that?
So it was actually adapted from a Norwegian show. It wasn't a novel or a book, and it was just a super weird situation. What happened was a piece of IP called Maniac, a little-known comedy that was only on Norwegian television, was acquired by Anonymous Content as a potential good vehicle for two stars as a two-hander. Anonymous Content took that to Cary Fukunaga and said, what about this? It's a half hour. He went to Emma Stone and Jonah Hill, and they all were like, this would be great. And then all of those people went to Netflix, and Ted Sarandos was like, let's make that show, straight to series. And then everyone looked around, and they're like, maybe we need a writer. But this is like, you know, this is... I could get all like bristly about how this is a writer's medium and it shouldn't be built that way. But the truth was that was an opportunity for me. I was a supervising producer on a show. I was a mid-level writer who had just enough experience, I think, to probably start feeling around.
Is this just after Leftovers?
This is as Leftovers is ending. They went 8 months and couldn't find a writer. Also, which it doesn't surprise me. I was too naive to kind of understand it. How obviously a danger zone kind of job that would be, or why bigger writers would be like, no, thank you. Because like you're going into an ecosystem with 10 producers and you're gonna be the 11th most important one in there no matter what. Even like you'll be the showrunner, but you'll be
You'll be doing the most work.
And that labor will go right to you because none of the people involved will be able to do it, but you will not be empowered to execute it. But as I said, I was too naive to quite to understand the power dynamics then. But I do think that was an opportunity I wouldn't have gotten to be a co-showrunner of a show with two huge stars and a great director, all set up at Netflix. Go, and back to your original question. The IP was very fun, but it was very problematic too. I think it was sort of like, wouldn't it be cool if two big stars could be in a thing together that was kind of in a fantasy space, but kind of not? But if you look at that show, it was a schizophrenic character and a therapist character, but the schizophrenic character, the man, was the one who got to be in sort of delusional spaces that his consciousness owned, and she was subordinated as a character inside of his fantasies, just sort of foundationally based on the setup of the show. So, you know, Emma wasn't going to be in Jonah's fantasy. It had to be, the power system wasn't right for that build. It needed to be shared back and forth more. So we had to really kind of take it apart. And then my wife's a therapist. Just the representation of mental illness generally in television, it was important to me to take it very seriously, I think emotionally, and not make a joke out of mania and psychosis, but to take it seriously emotionally. And that was a challenge, and that made it less funny and like weirder and different. But I think it was a great chance to like really adapt hard, you know, like and really just rebuild a thing. And those guys were great too, the Norwegian creators on top of it all. They weren't really involved, but they came and they visited. So it was a really unusual situation, but it was a great opportunity for me, and I love that show. It's kind of weird, crazy monster of a show, and it was very hard to make too, but it was great for me.
You evidently do not shy away from a challenge, Patrick. This is what we've learned.
Everyone in this room wants to go do it, you know? Like that, yes. I think that's the feeling. Like we're weird writers who, like, but at the same time, it's like let's go make a thing.
Right. Well, we all appreciate you coming today, and your amazing wisdom has been so inspiring. And also, just thanks for showing up today too to hear these guys. It's we know it's not easy to get out, but we really appreciate it.
Thank you guys.
And good luck to everyone. Keep trying. Don't give up. Take care. Thank you.